Hello everyone. So in this video we are going through the calcium metabolism. Why calcium is so important for our body? Because it provides structural integrity of the skeleton, activate biochemical processes inside our body, for example neuromuscular excitability, synaptic function, blood coagulation, hormonal secretion and second messenger, enzymatic regulation, cardiac and smooth muscle contraction. So all these are the active biochemical processes in which the calcium ion plays a vital role. Without calcium ion, these all processes are not possible. So that is why the calcium ion is important. In which form it is present inside our body? Forms of calcium ion in the blood. Out of all total calcium ion, around 40% calcium is protein bound, which is non-diffusible, and 60% it is the ultra-filtrable. Out of this 60%, 10% complex to anions, and it is the diffusible pool of the calcium ions, and around 50% it is the ionized calcium, which is active form. So that is the forms of calcium in the blood. And normal range 8.5 to 10 mg per dl in the plasma. What are the sources of the calcium ion? Milk product, fish, eggs, almonds and beans, cereals, rice, green leafy vegetables. Now the daily requirement of the calcium ion for infants 400 to 600 mg per day, for children 800 mg per day, for adults 1200 to 1500 mg per day. During the pregnancy and lactation, the daily requirement is more than that of the normal adult woman. When the age of females more than 50 years, they required calcium more than that of the 50 plus males, because estrogen leak in females after the menopause. So after menopause, the female doesn't have the deficiency or decrease in the levels of estrogen. That's why the 50 plus females require higher calcium than that of the 50 plus males. Now when we are speaking about the calcium metabolism, we must have to know about the bone cells, bone remodeling cycle and all the physiological aspect of the bone. So there are four different types of bone cells. First one, osteocyte. It maintains the bone tissue. Second one, osteoblast. It forms the bone matrix. Third one, osteogenic cell. These are the stem cells which are present in the bones. And fourth one, osteoclast. These are the resorbs bone. That means the bone resorption process takes place under the osteoclast. So these are the four different type of bone cells: osteocyte, osteoblast, osteogenic cell, in osteoclast. Okay, now the bone remodeling cycle, starting from the resting bone surface where the pre-osteoclast cells are present, and once the osteoclast cells become active, it causes the bone resorption process. And after the bone resorption process, there are few cells which are known as osteoblasts, and these are in the pre-osteoblast phase, and it causes the reversal of the bone resorption process, and this activity of the osteoblast causes the bone formation. And once the bone formation process takes place, there will be the mineralization of the bone. It will be the ultimate process after that, and in that there will be the comes under the cells of the osteocyte. And again, there is the same thing is happening. When there is a needed of the calcium, this resorption process takes place, and when there is a deposition of the calcium, bone formation as well as mineralization process takes place. So from the normal bone up to the level of this point, it is around 30 to 40 days for the resorption process of the bone. And bone formation process, it is all from this point to this point, and it takes around 120 days. Okay, so that is the bone remodeling cycle. Adjust the strength according to the stress. That means the strength of the bone is adjusted according to the stress which has been impacted or given on the specific bone. That means the bone which having the higher stress, they having the higher strength. Now, how the calcium is exchanged between the ECF and bones? So in the structure of the bones, there is a labile pool of calcium is there. So as and when needed, this pool of the calcium is diverted towards the blood vessels and blood. So calcium rapidly enters the ECF without breaking down the mineralized bone. So this labile pool of the calcium ion release immediately as and when needed inside the blood pool. And hence the calcium rapidly enters the ECF without breaking down the mineralized bone. So that is the mineralized bone not possible to break immediately to release the calcium ion from the mineralized bone. So it will take some little more time, but meanwhile the immediately there is a release of labile pool of the calcium ion into the blood and it provides the calcium ion to the blood pool. Now, the which hormones are responsible for calcium homeostasis? There are different hormones which are responsible for the calcium homeostasis. First one, it is the parathyroid hormone. Second one, calcitriol. It is also known as 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol or 1,25-DHCC. It's a vitamin D3 derivative and it is mostly present from the sun rays as well as from the diet sources. Now, the third important hormone, which is the calcitonin, it is released from the C cells of the thyroid gland. And some other little bit hormones which regulate or participate in the calcium homeostasis, this includes the estrogen, glucocorticoids and growth hormone. Okay, now starting from the vitamin D3 derivative, that is the 1,25-DHCC dihydroxycholecalciferol. So in the intestine, it increases the calcium absorption from the food which we have consumed. On the bone, it increases the calcium resorption. It increases the osteoclastic activity, that means bone destructive activity or bone demineralization activity. And it also increases the membrane permeability to the calcium ions. In the kidney, it decreases the renal excretion of calcium and phosphate ions. So here the conclusion is that it increases the serum calcium level. Now the second hormone, it is the parathyroid hormone. And this parathyroid hormone, it is released from the chief cell of the parathyroid gland. Now this chief cell secretes the parathyroid hormone. Parathyroid hormone is a peptide hormone and increases the plasma calcium level. Now, what are the actions of parathyroid hormone? Parathyroid hormone is activated when there is a condition of hypocalcemia. What is hypocalcemia? Decrease serum calcium level. So that is the hypocalcemia, which activates the parathyroid gland and hence there is a release of the parathyroid hormone. Now, what is the effect of parathyroid hormone? In the bone, it increases the resorption process. So the calcium ion is released and it decreases the deposition of calcium ion inside the bones. So ultimately there will be increase in the calcium ion inside the plasma or the serum. Now in the kidney it increases the reabsorption of calcium ion and excretion of phosphate ion. So that is the second thing. And the last one in the intestine along with the 1,25-DHCC, it is also increased the absorption of calcium and phosphate ions. So now the ultimate conclusion is that there will be increase in the extracellular fluid calcium ion back to the normal level. So this parathyroid hormone release takes place only in the conditions of hypocalcemia. Okay. So now how does it act on the bones? How the parathyroid hormone act on the bones? Firstly, the parathyroid hormone shift the labile pool of the calcium ion from the bone fluid into the blood. So that is the first thing which is happening and it is possible via the membrane bound calcium pump. So here the membrane bound calcium pump is present which shifts the labile pool calcium inside the blood. Now it also stimulates the bone dissolution or the bone resorption process so that the stable pool of the calcium and phosphate ion, specifically of the stable pool of the calcium ion, is also shifted towards the blood. So this is the way how the parathyroid hormone act on the bones to increase the calcium ion inside the blood. Now the third hormone, it is the calcitonin. Calcitonin is released from the thyroid gland C cell. Now what is the effect of calcitonin on the our body calcium pool? So when there is an increase in the calcium ion concentration in the extracellular fluid, it causes increase in the calcitonin level or calcitonin secretion from the C cells of the thyroid gland. And this calcitonin causes the inhibition of the osteoclastic activity. That means bone destructive activity has been stopped, and so there will be decrease in the mobilization of calcium and phosphate ions from the bone, and hence there will be increase in the net deposition of calcium and phosphate ion in the bone, and ultimately there will be decrease in the extracellular fluid calcium ion concentration. So that is the opposite effect of calcitonin than that of the parathyroid hormone and 125-DHCC. In the parathyroid hormone and 125-DHCC, this both increases the blood calcium level. Now the calcium homeostasis. Here the two main hormones took part in the maintenance of the calcium homeostasis. First one, it is the parathyroid hormone, and second one, it is the calcitonin, and both of these hormones have in the opposite effect. So first one, parathyroid gland, which releases the parathyroid hormone, and it acts on the bone, kidney and intestine, and ultimately it increases the plasma calcium level. And once the plasma calcium level is increased, it inhibits the parathyroid gland, so there is no release of parathyroid hormone from the parathyroid gland. Now when there is a increase in the calcium ion concentration inside the plasma or the conditions of hypercalcemia, it stimulates the C cells of the thyroid gland to release the hormone which is known as calcitonin. And now this calcitonin hormone having the effect over the bones and kidney, decrease in the calcium ion concentration in the plasma. And once the calcium ion concentration is decreased, ultimately it inhibits the C cells so that no more calcitonin is released from the C cell. Now once the calcium ion decrease inside the plasma, that means the conditions of hypocalcemia, it's again stimulating the parathyroid hormone, and again there is a release of parathyroid hormone which ultimately leads to increase in the calcium ion. And both of these hormones, parathyroid hormone and calcitonin, works in a balanced manner to balance the calcium ion level inside our body. So that is the calcium homeostasis. Now for example, we have consumed the 1000 milligram of calcium from our diet, and under the effect of 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol, that means 125-DHCC or vitamin D3 derivative, around 350 milligram of the calcium ion is absorbed and went into the extracellular fluid pool. From the extracellular fluid pool, some amount of concentration is entered inside the bone for the bone deposition process, and some amount of the concentration is filtered inside the kidney and excreted inside the urine. And from the extracellular fluid, around 150 milligram of the calcium ion is again coming back to the intestine, and around 800 milligram of the calcium ion is excreted. So that is the normal thing which is happening. Now here the two hormones which plays a vital role, one it is the parathyroid hormone and second one it is the calcitonin. So that is the process of bone resorption. When there is an effect of parathyroid hormone, it stimulates the bone resorption process. Hence the bone becomes weakened and weakened because the calcium ion is coming back to the extracellular fluid. And this parathyroid hormone also increases the reabsorption of calcium ion from the kidney. And both of these combinedly causes the increase in the calcium ion inside the extracellular fluid and ultimately to the blood calcium pool or serum calcium pool. Now the opposite effect, that of the calcitonin, it inhibits the bone resorption process. So when the bone resorption process is inhibited, that means the domination of the bone deposition process, and hence this calcitonin hormone helps in the bone formation process. So that is the ultimate way of handling of the calcium ion inside our body, and it is known as calcium homeostasis. Now the applied aspect of the calcium homeostasis. First one, tetany. When there is a decreased calcium level, it causes spasm of the muscle, that is known as hypocalcemic tetany. Now which are the causes of tetany or hypocalcemic tetany? First one, hypoparathyroidism. Now what is the reason behind this hypoparathyroidism? First one, it is the surgery and for example autoimmune disease. Secondly, rickets, which having the vitamin D deficiency to the absorption process of the calcium ion from the intestine is not occurring in normal way. Third one, intestinal sprue and chronic renal failure. So intestinal sprue, that means the calcium absorption process is defective. So in the chronic renal failure, that means the calcium absorption is not possible. Fourth one, it is the alkalosis. Now what is the pathophysiology of the tetany? Nerves and muscle become hyperexcitable, leading to spasms. So that is the hypocalcemic tetany. Now we already know that this calcium ion plays a vital role in the excitability of the muscles as well as the muscle contraction. Now, which are the clinical features of the tetany or the hypocalcemic tetany? So first one, it is the carpopedal spasm, which is also known as acousticus hand. Now the second sign which is present, it is the trosus sign. It is same after tying sphygmomanometer cuff, that is what it is looks like. The third one, it is the laryngeal stridor, crowning inspiratory sound due to laryngeal spasm. So in the conditions of hypocalcemia, there will be laryngeal stridor, so there will be crowning inspiratory sound due to laryngeal spasms. Wostek sign, tapping the facial nerve at the jaw angle, which causes the ipsilateral facial muscle spasm. So that is the known as Wostek sign, when we are going to tap the facial nerve at the angle of the jaw, it causes the ipsilateral, that means same side facial muscle spasms. For example, I am tapping the right jaw angle over the facial nerve and it causes the right facial muscle spasms. Now what is the treatment of this hypocalcemic tetany? So we have to give the IV injection of calcium gluconate, high vitamin D and calcium in the diet. So these are the treatment options which we have to prescribe to the patients or we have to advise the patient. Now the rickets. When the vitamin deficiency takes place in the childhood, then the condition is known as rickets. Now what is the causes of vitamin D deficiency? Inadequate intake inside the diet as well as the less exposure to sun. So people who are living in the areas where the sun rays are not properly coming to the earth, so these are more having the vitamin D deficiency. Now which are the clinical features of these rickets? Mainly present inside the children, calcium and phosphate deficiency in the ECF. When there is a conditions of hypocalcemia, there will be decrease in the calcium and phosphate level inside the extracellular fluid. It weakens the bones and bowing due to weight bearing. So due to excessive weight, this type of deformity or the deformation bone is takes place. In the later stages, tetany may develop, hypocalcemic tetany specifically. Now what is the treatment of rickets? Increased dietary calcium and phosphate ion as well as the large amount of vitamin D we have to given to the patients of the rickets. Osteomalacia. Which are the causes of osteomalacia, which is known as adult rickets? The causes includes the dietary deficiency of vitamin D or the calcium ion, steatorrhea and renal damage. So that is what the reason behind the osteomalacia. Now how the renal damage causes the osteomalacia or decrease in the calcium ion concentration? Because here the activity of the vitamin D or activation of the vitamin D is occurring through the kidney. So step by step its activity takes place through the kidney. When the kidney is damaged, the vitamin D activation process is hampered. So due to this, there will be decrease in the vitamin D and hence there will be decrease in the calcium ion concentration and hence there will be the conditions of hypocalcemia, which is known as osteomalacia or adult rickets. Clinical features, severe bone disability. So that is the clinical feature of the osteomalacia. So this is what happening in the patients of the osteomalacia. What is osteoporosis? When the process of bone resorption exceeds the formation. That means when the resorption process is more than that of the bone formation process, the condition is known as osteoporosis. Now, which are the causes of osteoporosis? Lack of physical stress on the bones. As we already know that the strength of the bone is directly proportional to the stress which has been given on the specific bone. So that is the first one, lack of physical stress on the bones. Second one, malnutrition, where the calcium concentration has been decreased inside the diet. Lack of vitamin C, space flights, postmenopausal woman due to less estrogen concentration in the old age, which due to less growth hormone and other hormone level, Cushing syndrome due to more cortisol level. So these are the causes behind the development of osteoporosis in a person. And here you are seeing the two photographs. One, it is the normal bone, and second one, bone with the osteoporosis. And here the clear cut vision is that this bone having the higher strength than this bone having the lower strength, so that the bone becomes weak. In the treatment options, we have to give patients calcium tablets as well as vitamin D supplementations. So I hope from this video you are now able to understand about the calcium metabolism and calcium homeostasis. If you like this presentation, please try to share it with your friends, groups, colleagues and batch. Thank you everyone.